Counsel for appellant.
Sorry, I'm trying to unmute myself. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. Okay, this is Catherine Young from the Federal Public Defender's Office for appellant Daronnie Thompkins. I'd like to reserve about 4 or 5 minutes of my time.
Watch your time.
I will. Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Thompkins is appealing his conviction and sentence for armed bank robbery. He raises a number of issues. The first one I'll turn to, unless the court has any other directions, is that the district court erred in denying his motion to suppress. And Mr. Thompkins argues that Powers, who would not admit his involvement in the robbery, but prolonged questioning applied psychological pressure on him, he broke down and made incriminating statements. Now, our first argument in this respect is that the officer Sanchez implicitly threatened to tell the judge that Thompkins was not cooperating, which is a violation of this court's opinion in Harrison, in which the agent or officer asked, would it be better if the judge were told that you cooperated or had not cooperated?
Well, just a minute. If we're looking at that, is my determination of that, is that for clear error review? Because the district court found that it wasn't what you're arguing.
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Well, you're suggesting that somehow this was compulsory on your client, that it, what was said there was compelling, was something that they shouldn't do, but the district court found it wasn't. So do I own any deference to the district court?
Well, the district court, if I'm understanding what the court is asking, the district court said, although the court is mindful of the possible implications of the agent's statements, the agent did not say he would inform the judge if defendant did not cooperate. So that, as I understand it, is the basis of the court's denial of the motion.
Well, I understand, but nonetheless, he made a determination that, as far as he was concerned, it wasn't what you're now arguing it to be.
Well, exactly. My point.
And do I owe any deference to that?
Our argument here would be that, first of all, the court seems to be.
Now, answer my question, please.
Okay.
Do I owe any deference to the district court, who heard the testimony, knows what the situation is, went through on the motion to suppress, and decided, hey, this wasn't compulsory at all. It wasn't that kind of a comment. Do I owe deference to that?
Oh, my argument would be that it's de novo because he applied the wrong standard. If it were the correct standard, it would be a clear error review.
What standard should he have applied that he didn't?
Okay.
What case does it come out of?
We're basing our arguments on Harrison and Casillas.
I know you are, but I'm trying to figure out, even the argument saying Harrison and Casillas, I'm trying to figure out what is there in those cases that is a different standard than the one he was applying.
Okay, Your Honor. The court, first of all, seems not to be considering the possible implications. He's also saying his factual finding is the agent did not say he would inform the judge if defendant did not cooperate. And my point is that this court's decisions in Harrison and Casillas don't require the agent to explicitly say, I will tell the judge if you don't cooperate. That there can be implications and there can be understandings arising out of...
Well, it seems to me that's the exact standard the court was applying in this case.
Okay, well, I would disagree because the court seems to be requiring the agent to explicitly inform the judge, and that's not what happened in Harrison and Casillas.
Well, but I just think that's an explanation of where he came out in the end result of applying the very standard you want to apply. He said, I've looked at this, and he didn't say what I think he should have said in this situation.
Well, I think that if you look at what was said in Harrison and Casillas, they were not the statements that the district court in this case, is requiring.
Okay, I understand your argument.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Could I ask you one more question that goes to the issue of harmless error?
Thank you.
I don't know what was in the statement that he actually made that hurt him, because the only real issue in the case was, for use of shorthand, his knowledge that it was that a use of a gun was foreseeable or whether he was aware of it. He did not admit to that. That was the only thing in which he basically gave an exculpatory statement. And I think that was helpful to him. Everything that he admitted to was overwhelmingly established by the surveillance, by the communications between him and those of his confederates who were in the bank, and the GPS which showed him in front of the bank just before the robbery and leaving the bank right after. The one thing that he did not say, and that was the critical issue in the case, that I, as I understand from reading your briefs, was that he was that the use of the gun was foreseeable to him. He denied that, and in effect, by the admission of this evidence, you were getting in essentially his defense. That was his exculpatory evidence that you couldn't have even gotten in had the government not foolishly offered the confession, because the way they try cases is to throw everything in the kitchen sink before the jury. But shame on them, but I don't see how it hurt you.
Well, I think one of the bases of harmless error is the fact that the government did insist on including it. They felt
That's always going to be the case. Otherwise, there wouldn't be any argument about error. The government, the government introduced it. In my view, shame on them. I just don't see how you're harmed by that confession. And in fact, you were helped by it, because you could not otherwise have gotten that exculpatory evidence in. You didn't. And when you tried this case on a stipulated testimony, his testimony was not included in the stipulation. So what you were able to do by the confession, I know there was no summation. I was looking for how it had been used in summation, but there were no summations here because of the way the case was tried. I think the confession helped him, not hurt him.
I think my argument would have to be that the government thought that it was harmful and included it. And also, and now I've lost my train of thought. Sorry, I can't think of the point that I was going to make.
Maybe move to your next point.
Yes, thank you, I will. Since Your Honor raised the firearm, why don't I move to the argument that the district court erred in calculating the advisory guideline range? Because that does have to, as Your Honor recognized, the firearm is a serious issue in that context. First of all, we contend that the government is required to meet the burden of proving the firearm enhancement by clear and convincing error because it had such a disproportionate impact on the sentence. And in this case,
Didn't the trial judge say he was actually applying that standard?
You know, I don't remember. Yeah.
He said he was applying a clear and convincing evidence standard in the statement that he made at the time of sentencing. I thought your argument was that he said something else, which sort of indicated that maybe he wasn't. But he said, considering Ms. Lester and her outside conduct, I think there's clear and convincing evidence there was an agreement to commit an armed bank robbery.
Okay, well, let me, I think that the fact that there's an armed bank robbery is not the standard for the enhancement.
But just a minute. There's no question your client didn't use the firearm, so one has to look at section 1B1.3B. And when one looks at section 1.1.3B, and one looks at what it says, then it seems to me, as my colleague has suggested, under a clear and convincing evidence standard, that the evidence meets it.
Well, we would strongly...
I mean, after all, your client gave Sessions the gun with the logical consequence of the conspiracy charge could not have happened without the involvement of the third party, because only Sohel had the key and the gun made him get it.
Okay, we disagree with the court's conclusion. The district court has to make particularized findings about what our client agreed to. All we have is the cooperative's testimony that our client had a gun and handed it and the same gun was in the hands of the...
Well, if you look at 1B1.3, you have to find within the scope of jointly undertaken criminal activity in furtherance of that activity, and now we're coming to the three, reasonably foreseeable in connection with the activity that occurred, that the commission of the offense of conviction in preparation of that offense or in the course of attempting to avoid detection or responsibility for that offense. That's what the district court's got to concentrate on.
That's right, Your Honor. And I would focus on the first one. It has to be in the scope of the jointly undertaken activity. The district court has to make particularized findings, what my client specifically agreed to. And I did want to, before I missed the point, that the court said that the third party Sohail had to be involved. And that's not the case. In fact, the testimony of Ms. Lester says that she didn't realize until she was in the vault room that she didn't have the key. Therefore, my client was not there at that time. So what he knew was what she knew before entering the vault room was that they could get in and get out, as the district court found, without involving any third parties. And unless there are any further questions, I see I'm at 4 minutes, so I'd like to reserve the remainder of my time.
All right, thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
We'll hear from the government. Mr. Chemerinsky. Hello?
Yes, good morning, Your Honor. Jeffrey Chemerinsky on behalf of the appellee, the United States of America. I'm joined by co-counsel Bruce Reardon, but I'll be handling the argument this morning. This court should affirm the district court, both as to the defendant's conviction and as to his sentence. As to each issue raised on appeal by the defendant relies on isolated facts and ignores the totality of the record and the facts presented. I'm happy to address any of the issues the court would like me to address. I'll plan to start with the suppression issue and why the court was correct in denying the defendant's motion to suppress, and why, in any event, this any error was harmless. The government submits that Harrison is distinguishable on at least two grounds. First is the district court correctly found the statements made by the agent are distinguishable from the statements made in Harrison. The district court found that those statements are different, and that's now reviewed for clear error, as Judge Smith recognized. Second, even if it rose to the level in Harrison, even if there is a Harrison problem, the court still reviews for the totality of the facts, the totality of the circumstances. Here, there are a number of facts and circumstances that make this distinguishable from Harrison, and that show that this was not an involuntary, the statements were not involuntary, the defendant's free will was not overborne. Those facts include the manner of the agent in handling, how he handled the interrogation. That for most of the time, there was just a single agent present with the defendant. As the district court noted, the agent was friendly and cordial throughout. The defendant, if the court reviews the video and audio from the interview, the defendant is clearly aware throughout of what's happening. He clearly goes back and forth with the agent. In fact, at 2 points, the agent says, "I'm getting pulled out," or indicates that he has to leave. And the defendant says, "No, no, no, please stay. I want to keep talking." All the facts here indicate that this was not a defendant whose free will was overborne. In fact, the audio and video show that the defendant was savvy and aware throughout of exactly what was happening. This was a defendant who was experienced in the criminal justice system. He had 7 adult convictions and 2 juvenile convictions. And based on all of these facts present, the court should find that this was not an involuntary confession, or the statements were not involuntary. But as Judge Corman recognized, the court doesn't even need to reach the Harrison issue, because this is a clear case in which the statements were harmless beyond a reasonable doubt. The evidence in the record at trial was overwhelming of the defendant's guilt. The evidence included the defendant sending, on the morning of the bank robbery, the 6-digit unique code to the men's bathroom, 871190. That men's bathroom then was the staging area for the gunman, prior to the robbery when he entered the bank. The other evidence was the co-conspirator's testimony, Iris Lester's statements, describing how the defendant picked out the day for the robbery, introduced her to the gunman, provided the gun for the robbery, that she sent the defendant a code that then initiated the robbery. And additional evidence included historical cell site data, which is used to track the location of a phone at this time. Here, historical cell site data showed the defendant.
Maybe you could move to the firearm enhancement, since that was her next argument.
Yes, Your Honor. Here, the court was correct in applying the firearm enhancement. The defendant, as the district court noted at sentencing, had already been convicted beyond a reasonable doubt of armed bank robbery. In fact, he received 2 points of credit for acceptance of responsibility for that offense. Under those facts alone, it would have been truly anomalous for a defendant not to have been found responsible for the firearm. But moreover, there was substantial evidence in the record showing defendant's knowledge of the firearm, including the defendant provided the gun to the gunman on the morning of the robbery. Defendant was the hub for the robbery, the connection point between the co-conspirator insider, Iris Lester, and the gunman. All that needs to be shown for the firearm enhancement is that it was reasonably foreseeable. And so it's a relatively narrow question for the court.
Well, but your opposition focuses on was within the scope of the jointly undertaken criminal activity.
Your Honor, there's two under 1B1.3, you have to show both, and it's essentially the same requirements under Pinkerton and the two cases cited in the government's 28J letter. You need to show both under the scope and reasonably foreseeable. Here, both are clearly met. The defendant conspired with Iris Lester and the gunman, he was the hub for both, to commit this bank robbery. He was found guilty beyond a reasonable doubt of the armed bank robbery. And then he provided...
But she specifically questions this idea that could not have happened without the involvement of the third party by saying that lady didn't even know that was going to be a problem, so she was as surprised, his co-conspirator was as surprised that he was, that they had to go get any third party.
And I recognize
that's her argument.
Yeah, but I think that her argument relies on the wrong standard, which is standard of knowledge and planning. That's not the standard that the government needs to show. It's a much lower bar, simply that it was reasonably foreseeable, which is why the question is simply a narrow one, which is whether the defendant, at the point he provided the gun to the gunman, it was reasonably foreseeable that the gunman would have to use it. And I would note here that the gunman didn't just use it on one victim. There, in fact, were two. There was Michelle Bernal and Mohammed Sahil, who were both held on their knees at gunpoint during the robbery. And certainly the defendant, that was foreseeable to the defendant who provided the firearm, that was a likely conclusion. This was a daytime armed robbery of a crowded bank during business hours. It was, again, taking even the facts, accepting defendant's gloss on the facts, all that's needed is reasonably foreseeability. And here, at the point defendant provided the gun to the gunman, it was reasonably foreseeable that someone could walk in, for example. That's accepting that it wasn't the plan all along. So I don't think the court needs to get into the specific question of what Sahil's, what was discussed ahead of time as to Sahil's role, because all that's needed is reasonably foreseeability, and that's a standard that's easily cleared in this case. Again, the defendant was convicted of armed bank robbery and, in fact, got 2 points of acceptance for that offense. He argued that he should have gotten a third point and argued that was in bad faith that the government didn't give him that third point. And so, having already been convicted of that higher bar, it was a logical conclusion at sentencing that the court would find the firearm enhancement as well. But the court also has ample evidence in the record based on the defendant's role at the center of this and the defendant providing the firearm to find simply on those facts that it was reasonably foreseeable.
But he got the 2 points off for acceptance of responsibility, as I understand it, because going to trial on the stipulation is what people would testify to and nothing more. It was really the functional equivalent of a guilty plea. And that's what justified the 2 points that you gave him.
Yes, Your Honor, and that's correct. And our point is simply that the having been convicted under the higher standard of guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, whether it's viewed as a guilty plea or a conviction, met a much higher bar than was then necessary for the court to find its sentencing.
Can I ask you one more question? Why did you offer the confession altogether?
I've asked myself that same thing as I prepared for this argument, Your Honor. I think I certainly agree with the court that it was unnecessary. It came about, the stipulated facts that were presented to the court were the result of significant back and forth in negotiation between the parties. I think if I could do it over, I probably would have just omitted it, but I think at the time that felt like it was too clear.
You learned the lesson that you don't need to throw in the kitchen sink in every case.
Yes, Your Honor. I'm happy to address any other issues or questions the court has. Otherwise, I would submit on my brief.
Thank you, counsel. Any questions? It appears not. Rebuttal?
Thank you, Your Honor. First, I wanted to address the argument with respect to the Harrison case that the prosecutor said the court still reviews for circumstances. And it's our position that in Harrison and Casillas, that's the end of the discussion. If both cases say there are no circumstances under which the law enforcement may make those comments. So we disagree that you have to do totality of the circumstances review in those cases. But now let me turn to the firearm. And the government is focusing on reasonable foreseeability, but that there are three tests. One of them is the scope of the agreement. And the sentencing guidelines, the cases cited in our briefs are clear. The court has to make particularized findings with respect to the scope of the agreement. And with respect to that, I'd like to point out that the court in the sentencing says, I'm not going to impose restraint because in my view, what the agreement was here, the plan was that he would get in, Iris would take him to the vault and they would get out without anyone else seeing them. That's what Daronnie Thompkins planned, not an armed
bank. Let me ask you a question, counselor. Have you reviewed U.S. v. Nichols? It's a 2006 case.
It says
that I can affirm the district court on any grounds supported by the record, even if it differed from the rationale of the district court. Why would that not be applicable here?
Well, because I don't think there is a basis for affirming the enhancement. I don't think there is any basis for...
You don't think there's any basis for saying, based on this record, that the defendant gave Sessions the gun with the logical consequence of what was going to happen?
Well, I don't think logical consequence is enough. I think there has to be an agreement and particularized findings as to that agreement.
Well, the agreement, there's no question there was an agreement. There's no question as to what the agreement, you were just arguing about what the agreement was. And the prosecutor said it was for... You take that gun and you deal with it whatever you have to, because this is going to be a dangerous operation. And you're saying, no, you take that gun for no good reason. Just walking in there and holding it. That's the two different stories I've got.
Yeah, and I think, you have to focus, too, on the district court's finding that the plan was to get in and get out. And what the prosecutor argued at sentencing was that the purpose of the gun was for the cameras. So that when Iris let Sessions into the vault room, she wouldn't just be bringing a friend into the vault room and handing him the money. She would be acting under duress. And therefore, the gun was for Iris's protection.
He could have given him a water gun.
Well,
that doesn't sound plausible. He gave him the gun because it was obviously, to my mind, the possibility that he would have to use it. And that was foreseeable.
Well, I think I've set forth my position, but there's one point I want to make before my time runs out, and that is there is a difference between a finding of armed bank robbery and this enhancement. And it showed up in the 28J letter that the prosecutor is citing cases. Just because there's armed bank robbery does not necessarily say that this enhancement applies, because there are three enhancements for armed bank robbery. You have to make particularized findings that this specific enhancement applies. That is the court did not do that. And unless there are any further questions.
Appears not. Thank you, counsel. Thank you to both counsel for your arguments in this case. The case just argued is submitted for decision by the court. Our final case on calendar for argument is United States versus Zendejas.